tangu mwaka ulipoanza hadi sasa hivi, na mahali popote nitakapokutaja ama nitakapowataja kama kikundi, nitaomba msima. Kundi la kwanza kulitambua, naomba ushers wote na choristers wa Sabbath School, mahali popote mlipo, kwa heshima ya mbingu, naomba msimame. Ushers wote na choristers wa Sabbath School, mahali popote mlipo, naomba msimame. Barikiwe sana. Hii ndio timu ambayo tumekuwa nao. Wanaporauka kwanza huduma ya soko. Sasa sikuni mwaka huu tumekuwa tukianza 7:30. Na mkuu maana sana katika na hii, na Mungu azidi kubariki. Kwa hapo ningeomba enda ya moyo kwa niaba ya waliosimama uweze kusalimia washiriki.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy day.
Happy Sabbath. Asanteni sana. Wa pili watambua, naomba viongozi wote wa Sabbath School Council, nyote mahali popote mlipo, naomba msimame. Maana nimewajua nyote kwa majina na kwa somo. Kwa hivyo naomba nyote msimame. Washiriki wa kaburi, hii ndio kikundi ambacho tunafanya nao kazi tangu mwaka ulipoanza, na kwa sababu ya wakati labda hatutaweza kuwatambua wote. Yule aliyeko nyuma pale ni na Liani, yeye ni naibu kiongozi na anasimamia hasa mgeni anapokuja, mgeni anakula vipi, analala vipi, jukumu lake liko pale. Amekuwa maana sana na ametusaidia katika idara. Mungu akubariki. Wa pili ni ndugu Mashogo, naomba mwendelee kusimama. Ndugu Mashogo, yeye amekuwa akishughulikia mashale ya mission. Wakati HDF anapomalizia duty, yeye ndiye anafikisha duty. Chiyoto ambayo iko next, nimepokea duty wa kuneneo misho mbili wakati ufao, na nimekuwa mzuri sana katika wakazi. Barikiwe ya dana. Ule wapande Lilian Mokera, ni naibu secretary, na nimekuwa amana sana pia kaida. Kiongozi mwingine ambaye tuko naye leo, ni dada Kate Kawera, ambao hayuko nasi siku ya leo. Huyu mwingine aliko hapo kona ni dada yetu Christine, yeye ndio Sabbath School secretary. Na kwa wakati huu ningewapa tu watu wawili nafasi aweze kuwasalimia. Wa kwanza atakayeweza kuwasalimia ni kiongozi wetu wa Sabbath School upande wa chemba, Ela Munywa, na usalimie washiriki.
Bwana ni mwema.
Bwana ni mwema. Wa mwisho atakayetusalimia mwisho ni kiongozi wa Sabbath School ambaye mimi mwenyewe nimevaa kiatu chake hapa mbele. Mimi ni naibu kiongozi, ila yeye ndio kiongozi wa Sabbath School. Kwa njia pekee kiongozi, naomba usalimie washiriki. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Barikiwe. Nikimaliza hapo na kuja mbele kuwaletea uliokuwa na wa kwanza pale upande wangu wa kushoto, ambao labda itakuwa mkono wako wa kulia, ni Eladiwa Shimoruri. Naomba simame na salimia washiriki. Yeye anawakilisha walimu siku ya leo. Asalimu washiriki kama na jambo ya sema.
Bwana Yesu asifiwe.
Amen.
Barikiwe.
Wa pili ni dada yetu Clara, ambayo anawakilisha Sabbath School ya Chabani. Naomba usimame, sendi wa chini.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy day.
Happy day.
Happy Sabbath.
Barikiwe.
Watatu ni kiongozi wa ya mbele HBF, yeye hapa mbele leo anawakilisha viongozi wa HBF. Karibu dada na usalimu wa chini. Huyo katikati itaruka kwa sasa, na pia sina mamlaka ya kukaribisha bila mkono ofisi, labda atakapokuja nyuma kuweza kutambua nasi. Nikija mkono wangu wa kulia, binadamu pia Yuka, naomba asalimie washiriki. Yeye anasimamia Choristers wa Sabbath School.
Sabato njema.
Njema sana.
Sabato njema.
Njema sana. Kabla ya kuketi, ningeomba elda wetu, kwa kuwa elda wetu ichanjwa Sabbath School leo hayuko nasi, elda Polo Pere, ila elda David Mosoki yena mbaki ya kishakele. Kwa hivyo elda, ndaka kukupa hii mali, naomba utumie sauti mbili yako na elda Polo Pere, usalimia ya washiriki, na pia utuletea mgeni mkuu.
Bwana asifiwe.
Amen.
Haleluya kanisa.
Amen.
Nadhani nimetumia sauti mbili. Nimetumia mbili. Nimesema Bwana asifiwe. Nikasema amen. Haleluya kanisa. Nikasema amen. Hiyo mechi. Sasa namleta mgeni wetu Pastor Jachire Ogalo. Awefu tu, wakati wako kifika, mtasikia sauti yake. Asante.
Nezea kabla sijataja jina, na ambapo na kikundi cha maana sana ambapo hatujawatambua, na ni especially naomba mmoja wao msimame aweze kusalimia washiriki. Nilikuwa na leta wageni wa Sabbath School, si mwingine ila ndugu Chiemo. Mungu awabariki na muwe na Sabbath njema.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy day.
call upon the choristers of our leader, the song. Let's stand up.
Kila mmoja wetu ameacha vyote ambao anafanya amefanya wiki nzima
amesema leo hakika lazima atambue uwepo wako. Asante kwa sababu tumeona ya kwamba kupitia kwa neno lako na kupitia kwa kifo chako hakika tumekombolewa kutoka kwa dhambi. Sisi sote ambao tumepiga magoti tunalia kucha kwako Mungu, waendelee kuturehemu, waendelee kutuonyesha neema yako na rehema ili tutasame msalabani kila wakati. Tunajua ya kwamba tuposi changamoto ya mwanadamu, lakini changamoto zote Mungu hakika siku ya leo, siku ya sabato tumezileta zote kwako. Hakika hilo tupatie bila yako ambao ni nyepesi, ili tukiendelea kutembea tutembee pamoja nayo kila wakati. Familia nyingi hakika zimepoteza wapendwa wao, hakika wako na huzuni, wengine wako na uoga, wengine wako na baridi, lakini asubuhi ya leo tumewakabidhi mikononi mwako. Wote watembelee hakika Mungu wapatie ujasiri na waendelee kuonyesha upendo wako, waonyeshe uwepo wako kila wakati, na tukajua ya kwamba siku moja utakuja kufuta machozi katika machoni yetu. Mungu hakika wacha jina lako litukuzwe. Hakika umetubariki na wageni siku ya leo, nimewakabidhi mikononi mwako. Wakati wanaenda kukaa hapa kusikiza neno lako, hakika wacha nao wakitoka hapa wawe wakitamani kusema ya kwamba kanisa la Bamburi ndio kanisa mahali wana wako wanastahili kukaa kwa kuabudu. Mungu tunajua ya kwamba mvua nayo imeleta changamoto katika nchi yetu ya Kenya. Watu wa Nairobi hakika wanalia na sehemu zingine. Mungu tunajua ya kwamba sisi ni wako na mvua ni yako. Tunaomba asubuhi ya leo Mungu, kama inawezekana usimamishe hiyo mvua, ili wana wako wamepoteza mifugo, wengine wamepoteza malazi, wengine wamepoteza nyumba zao, wengine wamepoteza maisha yao. Hakika uonekanie, usimamishe mvua, wenye wako hai watakuja kutoa ushuhuda kwa yale ambayo umewafanyia. Wacha jina lako litukuzwe kwa sababu Mungu anaendelea kuwa pamoja nasi. Mnenaji wa siku ya leo tumemkabidhi mikononi mwako. Mungu huyu mnenaji alitoka pale akatumia vyombo vimetengenezwa na mikono ya wanadamu kwa sababu ya kueneza injili kwa mataifa, mahali ambapo mji wa Mombasa ni mji ambao umeathirika kwa maovu mengi. Lakini siku ya leo tunamwombea hakika sauti anayoenda kutoa mbele ya wana wako isikike, na wale ambao wataisikia hakika wanyenyekee na wakaribie kwao. Wacha jina lako litukuzwe na linulewe, na umesikia ombi letu, na tumeomba katika jina la Yesu aliye mkombozi wetu.
Kuzoa kilicho cha Mungu Naomba watoto wa makaburi waweze kuja kwa wimbo wakimaliza, alafu watakwenda na wachezaji. Tutaomba hadi tumalize. Asante Mungu awabariki.
Thank you. Mungu, tuwe ni zaka zenu, Sitaoko mamoya ni pata yo, mali na juwa, wana yukona. what the story wants us to do, that the Jesus man is going to do.
Amen.
Our topic is, let God be. Can you talk to me?
Let God be.
Let God be.
Let God be.
Not let. Let. Let God be.
Let God be.
Yeah, that is our topic for now. Now, our story comes from the book of 1 Chronicles chapter 13. Which I'm not going to read, but I'm just going to paraphrase because of time. In Israel, there was the Ark of the Covenant. It was a symbol of God's presence and authority. Say, in Israel, there was the Ark of the Covenant, which was a symbol of God's presence and authority. Now, whenever the Israelites were, while they were doing their worship, when they started to kanisani kufanya ibada, the Ark of the Covenant was there. When you are going to tembea jangwani, that Ark of the Covenant was with them. Hiyo ilikuwa inaashiria kwamba Mungu yuko nao. Now the Israelites took this Ark of the Covenant as something normal. Waliona tu ni kitu ya kawaida. Hawakuona hiyo ni authority ya Mungu yuko nao. They took God for granted. So one day when they went to war with Philistines, like sisi in Kenya, sivyo? Sasa tunapigana na watu wa Uganda. Wakati umesikia kuna country inaitwa Uganda. President wa Uganda anaitwa nani? Maana najua president wa Uganda. Hakuna mwenye anajua. Kuna mwenye anajua? Haya, sasa walikuwa wanapigana na the Philistines. Na Kenya tunapigana na Uganda. Alafu wakaleta the Ark of the Covenant to the war field without consulting God first. Sasa walipigana, wakapigana hadi watu wa Philistines wakawashinda. Kwa nini walishindwa? Yet they had the presence of the Lord with them. Because they did not consult God. They took it as something normal. Now, waliposhindwa, the Philistines went with the Ark of the Covenant in their country. So the glory of God departed Israel. Like sasa watu wa Uganda watupige na waende na ile shindi yetu ile ya president wa Labeka. So the Israelites remained without the Ark of the Covenant. Now 7 months later, when David was now a king, that fight took place during the reign of King Saul, the first president or the first king of Israel. So 7 months later, after David had become a king, David akaonelea waende walete nini Ark of the Covenant. Now the Ark of the Covenant walimwenda nayo kule Filistia haingeweza kuishi huko. So walipeleka kwa ile nyumba ya they were worshipping gods with small g, idols. So when they took it to their temple, the first time their god was called Dagon, fell down. The next time when they came back, Dagon's head was in pieces. Wakaipeleka kwa town nyingine na sasa tuko Mombasa, wakaipeleka Nairobi. Watu wa Nairobi naye wakaanza kukufa, wakaitoa hapo, wakaipeleka Kisumu hivyo hivyo. And then they said, hii kitu ya Mungu ya Israeli hatuwezi kaa nayo hapa, wacha tuirudishe kwao. Now as they were taking it, because they were not Israelites, they did not know how to handle it, wakachukua wangapo mayo na ng'ombe, wangapo wanajua ng'ombe. Now they took 2 cows, wenye walikuwa kuna watoto wadogo, wakatengeneza mkokoteni, wangapo mayo na mkokoteni. Haya, wakaweka Ark of the Covenant hapo ndani, na wakaweka vitu zingine walitengeneza zinakaa kama panya. Usimonize, they were so sorry for taking the Ark of the Covenant to their country. Wakaweka hapo ndani, alafu wakashikia hizo ng'ombe zikienda na hiyo Ark of the Covenant. Now God directed that Ark of the Covenant back to the land of Israel. Now the Ark of the Covenant stayed there in the house of somebody known as Abinadab. In the house of somebody known as walipopeleka hapo, sasa ndio Daudi baadaye akaona itolewe hapo ipelekwe kwake. So yoga na sitoki with his army. Si hata kwa Kenya tuko na wanajeshi. Akaongea na kiongozi mwenye analinda 1,000 army men, akaongea na wale wenye analinda 100 men. And then wakaamua and all the Israelites. Wakamua watwe the ark of the covenant, waimbishe wapi? Nyumbani. Well, David was staying in Jerusalem. Now when they came, when they agreed, they decided to get this ark of the covenant from Abinadab's house. And there were two Levites. Ark of the covenant, ilikuwa wakitaka kutoka na imani wakienda kwingine, ilikuwa inabebwa kwa gold, hapa, with four men. So, that time they used the method that the Philistines had used. Nilisema wa Philistia walibeba aje. Nani anaweza ajua venye walibeba?
Walichukua ng'ombe wawili na wakachukua mkokoteni.
Sasa Waisraeli hawako wanafaa wabebe hivyo, sababu Mungu kuna venye aliwaambia wanafaa wafanye nini? Wabebe. Na kuna wenye walikuwa wanafaa wabebe hiyo hapo kutoka na known as the Levites. So the priest walikuwa wanatangulia mbele, alafu the four Levites walikuwa wanaibeba kwa mgongo, and then watu wanakwaya wote, si mmemba hapa, walikuwa wanafuata wakiimba. But they didn't use the right way. Wao pia walitumia tu ile njia yenye Wafilisti walifanya nini? Walitumia. And the choir was singing and everybody was happy. Walikuwa wanatumia musical instruments. Wakati wanaita musical instruments, kama gari. Sheka, nyingine ni gani, nyingine ni gani?
Ram.
Ram, another one?
Piano.
Piano, another one?
Trumpet. Guitar.
So nini kabiku, another one?
Violin.
Hizo zote, violin. Sasa, hizo zote walikuwa na wanatumia, wakiimba wamefurahia, wanarudi na the ark of the covenant. The presence of the Lord is again going to be with us. Alafu walipofika kwa threshing floor, penye wanatengeneza ngano, mahali inaitwa Kidon, zile ng'ombe zenye zilikuwa zimebeba moja ikaenda ni kumi inaanguka, alafu the ark of the covenant was shaken in the cart. Cart ni mkokoteni. And then one of the Levites who was leading, the sons of Abinadab, who was leading the ark, akaenda kuiguza. Alienda kuiguza, got struck him and died. Now, do you think these people were happy again? Unadhani watu walikuwa naimba tena? So everybody was sad, even King David was sad. And they were asking, mbona Mungu ameua Uza? And then David said that, kama hii kitu imeua Uza, hii kitu yenyewe kwangu. You know, my name Kifo. So David decided to direct the ark of the covenant to somebody who was not an Israelite. When you're going to issue hapo, like what happened in Costellians? What happened in Costellians? Mugiliyama, Mchoni, what happened? Inya Mjui Kweli. What happened when I talk about it? What happened when I talk about it? So, wakaenda, like kama yuku chidupi nafanyika hapa Mombasa, wakaenda, wakaipeleka kwa nyumba ya wenye anatoka wapi? Bara. Huyu mtu akufe, wao wasikufe. Watongasa wasikufe, wao wenye mwenye anatoka bara yafanye nini? So they took it to the house of somebody known as Obed Edom. Somebody known as? Alikuwa anaitwa nani? Obed Edom. Obed Edom was a Gittite hapo Israeli. So walipopeleka hapo, the covenant hapo, Obed akaangalia, akaambia familia yake, we are not Israelites, but King David has brought this ark of the covenant hapa. Tafadhali na waomba familia yangu, kuanzia watoto, mama na mimi na mtu yeyote ambaye anaishi hapa kwangu, don't touch that ark of the covenant wherever it is, because that is the Lord who is with us. So walipokuwa wakifanya kazi yao, hakuna mwenye alikuwa anakuza hiyo ark of the covenant. After 3 months, because they were faithful, God blessed Obed Edom. Wangapi wameona blessings za Mungu? Wangapi Mungu amewahi bless? So mjawahi kwa bless? Mungu amebless na nini? Food? Wengine anasema food. Shout. Gari. Wazazi. Mami. Hizo ndio blessings tunajua. Shelter. 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 God shout. So, Mrs. Zote is recovered to our open bedroom. Now, because of time, our story is going to end there. But I want to say that Obed Edom was blessed because in as much as Hakam Israel, Hakam Najua, the rules of the Israelites, because lakini sasa kwa walikuwa meishi pale, alikuwa naelewa kila ambacho Mungu alikuwa anafanya nini, anahitaji. That is why he directed his family never to touch that ark of the covenant. And in 3 months, God demonstrated to what King David thought was going to be a curse to a Hittite by blessing him. So let God be watoto. Mkikuja kanisani, let us worship God, knowing that Mungu ni mkubwa kufanya nini kutuliko. Na yeye ndiye ametuumba. Tusicheze na Mungu, tusikue Mungu, let us not take God to be normal. Let us not take worship to be normal. And to our parents and upcoming parents, my plea to you is that as we teach our kids in the Lord, let us not use our human wisdom, but let us use the scripture to guide us into teaching them how to obey God and to know the right ways of the Lord. Now, our key text comes from the book. Naya najua kufungua Biblia na karaka. Our key text comes from the book of 1 Samuel chapter 12. 1 Samuel chapter 12, verses 24. 1 Samuel chapter 12, verses 24. Kipata? 12 verses 24. First Samuel chapter 12 verse 24, it says, "But be sure to fear the Lord and serve him faithfully with all your heart. Consider what great thing he has done for you." Amen. Tunaambiwa, be sure and serve the Lord with truth. And consider what the Lord has done for us. Mkiambua muimbe, muimbe na ukweli. Mkiambua mnyamaze, mkiwa hapa ndani, mnyamaze. Sababu the God that we serve is a God that has blessed us, a God that is beyond us. Mungu mwenye ameshinda hata wazazi wetu. Now, my questions, very fast. What was our topic? Yes, Jane, shout. Let God be. What happened to the Ark of the Covenant as they were bringing it back? Ajui. Who died? Who died when they were bringing the Ark of the Covenant back?
A Levite.
Levite. Jinaka alikuwa anaitwa nani? Alikuwa anaitwa Uza. So, what is the moral of the story? Hii story inatufundisha nini?
Be faithful.
Don't lose our faith in God. Soka karibu, soka karibu. Be honest. So all those are our answers, but the main one is we should not serve God with deliverance. To be served whom to serve now when. Nani anatuombea tukimaliza? Nani anatuombea? Ni msichana ndiye alituombea. Boy, come. Njoo. You.
Let us pray. King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, we thank you this afternoon. Thank you for finishing with us the children's story. As we are still here, hearing your word of God, may help us to listen to your word. Let us, we are going for lunch. May you bless the food, may you make it nutritious. Let us, in the evening, as we are going home, may you cover us with the Lord's cross and the shame of the cross. May you just surround us. And if we come back home safely, we'll be happy and lift the name of Jehovah. I bless you and whom are you? I pray for my teachers, my friends, whatever they are, maybe whatever their point of view is. Jesus Christ, I pray and I believe. Amen.
You love my story.
Yes,
you love my story to
this.
Truly,
thank you, Sister Sally, for the given sermon. Indeed, it It is a story that contains profound lessons, not just for children, but even for adults. A story that reminds us about the sanctity of God and how God sometimes can go dramatic to vindicate his holiness. May God bless you in Jesus' name. May I start by thanking God Almighty, in whose presence we are all here gathered. I had mentioned during the week that where I was born and raised, which is the western part of our country, a county called Homa Bay, it is joked that the first person who attempted to speak Kiswahili died on the spot way back in 1923. So there is an existential phobia towards that language. And so I will do this message in English. Nitaweza kuendeleza kipindi hiki kwa lugha ya kimombo, and I will not be very flexible about it. Nonetheless, heaven will speak to us. That is not to say that English is a measure of intelligence. No. English is a language like any other, and every language is very rich, if not abused. Permit me to thank the church leadership, elders, and the church pastor in absentia for supporting every department of the church. That is what we teach the elders of a local church. Programs of this nature, you may not know, they often come with a lot of logistical challenges. And it takes the goodwill of the church leadership to have them effective in this manner. So wazee mnafanya kazi nzuri, and may God bless you. May I also thank the Sabbath School Department for making the church to feel your presence. Sabbath school is simply a school run on a Sabbath. And the textbook or curriculum used in Sabbath school is the Holy Bible. The teacher is the Holy Spirit. And the pupils and students in the Sabbath school is all of us. So really, Sabbath school is a program for all members. That is why I belabored to demonstrate to you through the week that you matter in the eyes of your Creator and your Maker. May I make a very special thanks to Brother George, Jojo Wino, I remember, and his wife. That family literally donated their car to ease our movements. They embraced the discomfort of public transport and the bad roads throughout the week, so that the work of the Lord may be efficient. And here I declare without fear of contradiction that may the Lord of heaven, in the abundance of his providence, bless that precious family in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Not forgetting to thank Sister Emily, the other name is Orua or Arua. She was so kind to us, doing our laundry, preparing our meals throughout the week. My comfort was her priority. Sister Emily and your family, your husband, may God bless you in Jesus' name. Permit me also to say a special tribute to Brother Ira, who hosted me. For the warm treatment, I thought he was allergic to the kitchen until this morning when he chose to surprise me. He made a very fantastic dish of egg omelette, as if to convince me that Emily was not present because of his weakness. I enjoyed Brother Aida, may God's favor be upon you all the days of your life. Our members who are able differently, God bless you, God loves you. May I tell you that when we all get to heaven, someday we will get home. And when we get home, nobody will be seated in heaven on a wheelchair. Nobody will be blind or dumb or physically challenged. For we will all be translated into immortality. And in a twinkle of an eye, we will all share the immortal, glorious body in heaven. Looking forward to meet you there. The only memory of sin in heaven will be the marks of scars in the bodies of Prince Emmanuel. Those will be the only memory that once upon a time sin existed on planet Earth. So God loves you and we love you more. I am Churchill. My wife is Christine. My boy is Jeff. Our girl is Rachel. And together we send you greetings in Jesus' name. Permit me to say a prayer as we get into the message. Holy Father, I come at the very tail end of our services to lift Jesus and Him crucified before this diverse audience. Dear Jesus, come and have thine own way. Yes, Lord, come and have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Will you make and mold me after thy own will? Not I, but Jesus, be seen, be heard, be known, and be exalted. In simplicity of language and with clarity of thought, will you reason with our conscience? Permit me to be effective one more time. I pray by faith in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Rediscovering my value in Christ. That is our sermon title. Rediscovering my value in Christ. Listen to this story before I take you to the text of the day. A devoted young lady called Joy had just arrived to the town seeking solace. And as a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, Joy was known for her deep faith and talent as a master guide and a renowned singer. Shortly after settling down in the city of Accra in Ghana, Joy became an integral part of the church community, particularly as a chorister. Her angelic voice during the Sabbath school services brought a sense of heavenly joy to the congregation. making her a beloved figure in the church and among the entire membership of the congregation. Her voice, a divine talent and instrument, echoed through the hallowed walls of the church during Sabbath services. Joy quickly became a celebrity, and everybody wanted to identify with her. However, sadly, Joy's life took an unexpected turn when she found herself pregnant. In a difficult situation, she was faced with the challenge of preserving the reputation of the church and the elder involved. Oh, dear elders, God have mercy on us. In an attempt to seal the elder's reputation and identity, Joy confided in a Dorcas mother in the church. The Dorcas mother, in whose heart and trust Joy confessed her faith, appeared to prioritize the church's image over Joy's dilemma, advising her to terminate the pregnancy. Unsatisfied with this counsel, Joy turned to her grandmother, a wise woman who valued every life as a gift from God. Using the biblical story of Solomon and the circumstances surrounding Solomon's birth, Joy's grandma encouraged her to carry the pregnancy, telling her that there is a potential for greatness even in the worst of circumstances. Encouraged by her grandmother's counsel, Joy chose to keep the pregnancy, rediscovering our value in Christ. Unfortunately, when the church leaders discovered Joy's pregnancy, they distanced themselves from her, and she faced suspension for a year. Choosing to defy the church's expectation, Joy embraced motherhood. Yet the very community that once celebrated her and once marveled at her angelic voice turned its back on her. The elder involved in her plight was among the church leaders that voted in the church board to suspend Joy from the church. However, Joy did not stop attending the church services. She continued. But every time she walked into her church, no one could talk to her. She was the face of stigma, and she was counted a social misfit. She would sit all alone, and every member of the church paid no attention. It is said in this story, church, that Joy's heart, a heart and soul which was once filled with joy of sharing her angelic voice with the congregation, now echoed with the haunting silence of abandonment. Church, the story says that Joy found herself navigating a storm of emotions, lost in the tempest of rejection. In the hallowed walls where her voice had once soared and blessed many, Joy felt the crushing weight and pain of rejection. The pews that once held friends now stood as silent witnesses to her solitude. The very sanctuary that was meant to offer solace became a haunting reminder of the love lost. Yet joy did not give up. Joy could cry at night, and her pillows absorbed the weight of her silent tears through the terrible dark nights of her life. It is said that some months later, after her suspension from the church, Joy mastered some courage to approach the elder who was truly involved in her story. The elder denied and warned Joy to keep quiet, lest he will deal with her, for he was a perceived big man. 9 months later, Joy gave birth to twin boys into a world that had cast her as an outcast. The once vibrant chorister found herself navigating the challenges of motherhood alone. Oh, this world, a cruel world that can move you too far, a world that can get you into circumstances you never thought you could go to. Life can make you do stuff that you had once vowed you can never do. A world that can push you too far into a life you had cast cannot come your way. But faith continued its relentless grip on Joy. Joy's health continued to wane, and ill health became her portion. In her final moments, the embrace of COVID-19 took her away, leaving the twin sons as a legacy of a woman forsaken by those she had once considered a family. Unaware of Joy's passing, and unaware of the existence of the twins, the church leadership decided to lift her suspension after a year. Shockingly, when they visited Joy's place, they learned that Joy had passed away, and she had left behind 2 sons who had been adopted by a white family from England when they visited Accra. The twins, embraced by the foreign family, became a symbol of the church's abandonment. Simultaneously, 2 days later, after the church leadership, including the elder who rejected the pregnancy, had visited the Joy's place to lift her suspension, faith dealt its own hand to the elder who played a role in Joy's plight. It is said in the story that the same judgment he had meted to Joy echoed back to him as a tragic road accident claimed the life of his wife and 3 children. The haunting echoes of Joy's story reverberated in his conscience, forcing him to confront the harsh treatment he had meted on Joy. The elder yearned to connect with the twins, but it was too good, too late. The story of Joy mirrors a story that is recorded in the book of Mark chapter 14. A story of an anonymous woman who is only identified as a sinner. The woman talked about in Mark chapter 14, from where our key text came, The anonymous woman talked about in Mark chapter 14 is anonymous not because she did not have a name, but because she was a victim of circumstance. It is said that this woman had a very popular brother, a brother named Lazarus, a brother who had been raised from the dead by Jesus. And the resurrection of Lazarus propelled him to national fame. But even the fame of Lazarus could not give this woman any identity because she was a victim of circumstance. Bible history records that this woman came from a very popular family. But even the popularity of her family could not give her any identity because she was a victim of circumstance. And church, today's message is a dedication to anyone in this audience who today feels like they are a victim of circumstance. Victims of cruel conspiracies. Victims of very deadly betrayals. Victims of blackmail. People who are hurt by the very ones they looked up to. The joys of our time. People who are nursing desperate wounds, unable to get over them. Heaven has sent me to plead with you and to tell you that Jesus alone knows the true estimate of a human soul. Only in the light of Christ can the true value of humanity be estimated. The words spoken by Christ in Mark chapter 14 verse 9 came as a commendation to a life that had sunk deep in sin, a life that had been treated as a social misfit. Unfortunately, time is not going to permit me to take you through this story, but it is a story of a woman betrayed in the hallowed corridors of a temple. Students of Bible history, especially Jewish history, agree that this woman was called Mary. And in Mark chapter 14 verse 9, the Bible says, "And truly I say to you, wherever the gospel is preached in the whole world, that also which this woman has done shall be spoken of in memory of her." Words that nobody expected to come from the lips of the spotless Son of God. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs. This character called Mary was known for two things. It is said in Bible history that Mary was humble in demeanor, a very humble lady. And further, Mary possessed a sense of physical beauty. The pen of inspiration describes Mary as one who was beautiful to behold. Inspiration says that Mary possessed a bewitching sense of beauty. She had an intoxicating beauty. And everybody wanted to identify with Mary. Every other morning, Mary would join Lazarus and Martha and other netizens of Bethany, their little village. They would walk to the Jerusalem temple where they would be taught about the Mosaic Code. While in the temple, Mary had the occasion to sit at the foot of a high priest called Simon. One day, Simon was attracted to the beauty of Mary, and Simon, a high priest, an anointed man of God, one who stands in the most holy, a person who walks and stands before the holy Shekinah, Simon descended too low. He defied the dictates of his office. Simon defied the moral conduct of priesthood. And Simon defied Mary. Let me pause for a moment and make this submission, friends. Anytime you will ever take advantage of your privileged position in the society and you wound innocent people of God, men and women placed under your charge, all heaven will be disappointed in you. Some of us are so privileged. We sit in offices, we hold positions where people can come and confide in us. People can tell us even intimate issues about their lives. Anytime you will take advantage of that trust and you make yourself the reason behind the tears of humanity, heaven will remind you that he is disappointed. I wish I had time to tell you what became of Simon. But sooner than later, he had to exit the honored office of priesthood and he joined the lepers beyond the gates of Jerusalem as a leper. Impunity will never last in the eyes of the Most High. Fellow Adventists, what do you gain by making someone's life difficult? What is your joy in my pain? What do you gain when a family is breaking in your name? What makes you happy when a life is wounded? Fellow Adventist, heaven has sent me to plead with you. Please make Adventism attractive. Make Adventism attractive. Be kind to people. You never know what they're going through. Kindness is the key to hearts. Simon of all the people defiled Mary. And you know what, church? The Mosaic Code, which is the supreme Hebrew law, they called it the Torah, had very strict provisions on sexual purity. Any Hebrew girl, then and even now, who was found to have lost her virginity in her parents' home, that crime was punishable by death. And so when Mary came of age and she wanted to walk into marriage, a test had to be done to confirm whether she was still a virgin. Lo and behold, Mary failed the test. Poor sister of Lazarus and Martha failed the test of sexual purity. The law of Moses prescribed stoning. So a council was quickly called. The highest judicial tribunal in the land, a council which was called the Sanhedrin, A council of 71 elders added that the chair of the council, by the way, Sanhedrin was like the supreme court of the land in ancient Israel. And Sanhedrin, the law, demanded that Sanhedrin is chaired by the priest. So can we imagine Simon organizing a council to discuss the fate of Mary, who is responsible directly for defiling? That is the cruel society in which we live. Like Joy, her case is presented before a board of elders, the very council where her tears began. Listen, church. The church should not alienate those who fall from grace. True spirituality is not found in perfection. True spirituality is found in the compassion and forgiveness extended to those who falter in the journey of faith. I may be a pastor, yes. You may be an elder, yes. But behind my title of pastor, there is a Churchill who needs a savior. There is a pain I am struggling with. True spirituality, the value of a human soul, is not found in outright perfection. And what drives me crazy about our world is that nobody cares to know the whole story. Ours is a society that is not interested in the whole story. Thank Jesus that my Father in heaven knows the whole story. Christ knows the circumstances that shaped Mary's experience. And so a verdict was given. A letter was written, taken to Mary, and that letter described Mary and declared her as a social misfit. That is how Mary exited the gates of Jerusalem and landed in a town called Magdalene. We live in a world that can push you to the wall and make you do things you are bound you can never do. Magdalene was known for two things. Magdalene was a very popular town in Asia Minor. A town where sex was idolized and worshipped as a god. A town where commercial sex was the new normal. Young women and ladies rented very palatial apartments in Magdalene. They would time the Roman soldiers from the other yonder who would come to quench their physical lust in exchange of cash. That was the business in Magdalene. Out of bitterness and pain, Mary was initiated into the life of harlotry. And did you know, church, there is no deadly animal like a woman on revenge mission? There is no dangerous animal like a man bitter in her hands and has chosen fate and doesn't care what she's doing with her life. Some people are in this town on revenge mission, beware. And so Mary got into harlotry. It did not take long before the society of Magdalene branded her name. She became a celebrity. You went to the beach, Mary. You went to the park, Mary. You came to church, Mary became a household name. And that is how she earned the name Maria wa Magdala. But this life is not patient with people. The same people who celebrated Mary became impatient with her. They said enough is enough. A conspiracy was hatched quickly to lay Mary at her. One day your sins will catch up with you. And even this big city of Mombasa will be too small for you. Early in the morning, the pen of inspiration says Mary hears a knock on her door. She was reluctant to open because in her entire life of adultery, she had never received a guest that early. Nonetheless, she gave it a try. After all, she was bitter. Wounded in the hallowed corridors of the temple by an anointed man of God. Many of you are nursing wounds, even now. Wounds that are attributed to people you once trusted. Those you least expected could hurt you. Your body is full of marks that you received in the houses of your friends. Church, in the interest of time, the Bible says that Mary was caught in the very act. She was taken to Jesus that they may get what Christ has to say. The spotless Son of God knelt down and with his hands, which were to be crucified on Calvary's nail, Jesus wrote a few inscriptions on the dust of the temple floor. The whole of Jerusalem was out for a story. There was a sense of satanic fury in the audience. Everybody shouted, "Adulterer! Shame! Adulterer! Shame! Stone her!" Mary was lying half dead in the outer court of the temple. You know, Jerusalem temple was divided into three. And so a harlot could not go into the most holy place. She was abandoned at the temple. Everybody was shouting the wild mob, "Adulterer! Shame! Stone her!" It was the darkest day in Mary's life. Poor sister of Lazarus, victim of circumstance, victim of a cruel betrayal in the most unlikely place. Mary remembered Jezebel of the Old Testament, and she resorted to share the fate of Jezebel and become the second Jezebel. This life. A life that is so uncertain. A life that is so unpredictable. A life that sometimes can make death appear preferable to life. But when the crowd saw the writings of Jesus, they learned that most of them had been Mary's client. And when Jesus looked up, he gave an order that you who is carrying a sword, you who is holding a weapon, you who is carrying a sword, any of you who is spotless and without sin, be the first to cast the stone. Church, stones were abandoned in the temple floor. Weapons were abandoned. Everybody sniffed one by one, and they looked at the next, the nearest possible exit out. And Mary was left with Jesus, two people. The Savior then bent his head, looked at Mary with a great sense of compassion, called her woman. Mary lifted her teary eyes. She was met by the abandoned heaps of stones. She looked at the entire compound of the church. When Mary saw the heaps of stones, when Mary saw the abandoned arsenals, when Mary saw the nature of swords scattered across the temple floor, she knelt at the feet of Jesus. Church, the best place to be at your darkest moment, at your lowest, the best place where you can find embrace and comfort is at the feet of Jesus. He knows the whole story. He understands the circumstances that have shaped your experience. Jesus asked Mary, where are your accusers? Mary answers, no one, sir. I'm not a lawyer, but at least basic knowledge tells me that when you are in a courtroom, the judge is seated, the accused is there, and the charge is so capital in nature that should it be proven can drive someone to a very worse sentence. So the judge is seated, the accused is in the court, but the accuser is missing. Not a single witness is willing to come. What happens to such a case? Dismissal. So Christ looks at Mary, and as a judge, he asks Mary, where are you accused? Is there anyone to testify against you? Mary tells Jesus that there is no one, sir. They are all gone. But Mary is quick to inquire from Jesus that, sir, I have you give opportunity to anyone who had never sinned. But because most of them were not spotless, they fled away. But Jesus, you, the law of Moses allows you to kill me. Savior, you are spotless. Savior, you have never sinned. You qualify before Mosaic code to take this sword and slaughter me. Will you kill me, Jesus? Will you stone me, Savior? I know you are a child of God. I know you are the Son of God. You cannot entertain adultery. I am chief of sinners. Will you kill me? I am at your mercy. Will you kill me, Savior? It is at that point that Christ stretched his hands, wiped the tears from the face of Mary, looked at Mary straight in her eyes, and told her, Mary, go. Please go. Just go. Mary, go. Please leave. And sin no more. That is the extent of God's grace. That is the depth of Jesus' life. Marvelous grace of our loving God. Grace that exceeds our pain and our guilt. Mary left the temple, and a few days later she decided to go and appreciate her master. News reached Mary that Jesus is attending a feast in the home of Simon. She went there with an expensive gift, an alabaster perfume. She knelt at the feet of Jesus. Tears falling from her face to the feet of Jesus, wiping the feet of Christ with her long hair, took their alabaster oil and anointed her master. That is when these statements were spoken in Mark 14:9. Surely I tell you, wherever this gospel is preached, what this woman has done shall also be spoken of as a memorial for her. What are you going through? Are you worse than me? What is this wound you are nursing? What is the color you are seeing? What makes you feel like you are beyond the reach of the saving arms of Jesus? Heaven has sent me to plead with you that only in the light of the cross of Calvary can your true value be estimated. You are not worse than Mary. Mary had been looked upon as hopeless. Her case had been looked upon as a great sinner. But Jesus understood the circumstances that shaped her life. When to human eyes her case appeared hopeless, Christ saw in Mary capabilities for good. He saw the better traits of her character. He understood the whole story. The plan of redemption today has invested humanity with great possibilities, and in Mary these possibilities were to be realized. Through the grace of Jesus, Mary became a partaker of the divine nature. The one who had fallen so low and whose mind had been a habitation of demons was brought very near to the Savior in fellowship and ministry. Your life can be fixed again. Your tears can be wiped by the Most High. It was Mary who sat at the feet of Jesus and learned from him. It was Mary who poured upon his head the precious anointing oil and bathed his feet with her tears. It was Mary who stood beside the cross and followed Jesus to the sepulchre. Did you know it was Mary who was the first person at the tomb after the resurrection? Yes, it was Mary who was the first to proclaim the news of a risen Savior. Jesus knows the circumstances of every soul. You may say, I am sinful, very sinful. And yes, you may be. But the worse you are, the more sinful you feel about yourself, the more you need Jesus. I have come to the end of this message, church. But I'm here to declare that while I do not know your circumstance, I may not know the nature of your battles, I may not know the tears you are shedding, but I am persuaded that there is no tear God cannot wipe. There is no life heaven cannot fix. There is no wound God cannot heal. What are you going? Why are you so low? You can still find solace under the arms of Jesus. I want to invite the women ministry team for an item, even as we pray together with someone who feels so low, so wounded, so betrayed, so down. You are almost contemplating revenge. you look at yourself and say, no, this is not my life. You want to carry your burdens to the Lord. I want to pray with such a person. I will want to encourage anyone who has not dropped her prayer request in the box, for we want to do a closing prayer. You are not worse than Mary. There is no life too dark that God cannot brighten. And as these women of faith gives us an item, feel free to walk up front. But because of lack of space, you will only drop your prayer item and receive your seat. Thereafter, we will pray together. Please come. Heaven is waiting. He who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. That is the divine decree. Welcome, women ministry. And after this item, I will be able to do a closing prayer. The experience has taught me that calls of this nature are not prolonged because it is about your destiny. I invite the old church to stand as we pray together. Holy Father in heaven, thank you, Eternal Father, for your love and compassion. The dramatic experience of Mary, from a guilty sinner to a forgiven saint, is a story of hope and consolation. And so, Lord, I lift this audience before thy throne of grace. Mere mortal, I am limited in knowledge. I may not know the circumstances of anyone in this audience, but I know you know. I plead with you, my Father in heaven. I have tested and tried you. I have known the beauty of serving you. I am a product of your grace and mercy. Extend that grace to any bleeding soul here. Fix any life that is broken or threatening to break. Heal any wounded spirit. And may this week act as a renewal of our spirits, that we may serve you in gratitude, knowing, Lord, that you understand every detail of our circumstances. Someone is in the valley of decision, Lord, wants to make a very personal choice and walk with you up to the waters of baptism. Heavenly Father, hold their hands. Help them overcome the stigma and fear of the public. Write their names in the records of heaven. Snatch them from the pangs of death. Give them a second chance. In this day of sacred pleasure, help us to continue communing with you. I lift the petitions brought in the prayer box to you. Eternal Father, these are burdens that can only be borne in Calvary. Eternal Father, read the contents of these letters, and you who understand the background of every request, grant them in the abundance of your mercies. To this end I pray, in the blessed name of Jesus Christ.
Tuwe wasikivu, tuwe wanyenyekevu kwa kazi yako. Para